Welcome to the American Monetary Association's podcast, where we explore how monetary policy impacts the real lives of real people and the action steps necessary to preserve wealth and enhance one's lifestyle.
Welcome to the podcast for the American Monetary Association. This is your host, Jason Hartman, and this is a service of my private foundation, the Jason Hartman Foundation. Today, we have a great interview for you, so I think you'll enjoy it. And comment on our website or our blog post. We have a lot of resources there for you, and you can find that at AmericanMonetaryAssociation.org. That's AmericanMonetaryAssociation.org, or the website for the foundation, which is JasonHartmanFoundation.org. Thanks so much for listening, and please visit our website and enjoy our extensive blog and other resources there. It is my pleasure to welcome Bob Prechter to the show. As I mentioned before, Bob is the president of Elliott Wave International, and he has a long-standing career and some excellent insights into markets. The Elliott Wave principle is a form of technical analysis that basically attempts to forecast trends in financial markets and other activities. It was developed in the 30s by Ralph Nelson Elliott, and he was an accountant who basically developed this theory that has a lot of support and a lot of backing to it. I think you'll really enjoy this interview. It's very insightful. And what's especially interesting is the stuff where we don't talk about money necessarily, but we talk about socionomics and social trends. So let's listen in and enjoy the interview, and we will see you very soon for show number 80. Well, I want to welcome Robert Prechter to the show. He's from Elliott Wave, and he's from Atlanta, Georgia. And Bob, it's great to have you on the show.
Well, thanks for having me.
Good. Tell us a little bit about your background, and then I want to get into Elliott Wave theory and talk about your book.
Well, I started on Wall Street in 1975. I went to work for Bob Farrell, who ran the technical department at Merrill Lynch in New York City. Stayed there 3.5 years, was completely itching to get out on my own, but I learned a lot there. It was a great place to be, and particularly New York City, because that was the only place that I could find a copy of R.N. Elliott's original writings, and he's the guy who originally wrote two books on what he called the wave principle and what some other people today call Elliott's wave principle. And they were in the New York Public Library on microfilm, and that really got me started because there was so much there that people weren't talking about, so much in the way of detail and a completely thought-out model of how stock market behaves and financial markets in general behave. It was a treasure trove. That got me started, and I met a man named A.J. Frost, who is from Canada, and his partner Hamilton Bolton had kept the wave principle alive in the 50s and 60s. And in 1978, we wrote a book together. That was back when the Dow was in triple digits, if anyone can remember that. And we were saying, this is a tremendous buying opportunity. We're finishing a long sideways bear period. We're calling it the fourth wave. That's 4- and 5-wave up moves. So there's a big bull market coming. And we were very aggressive in calling for the market to get as high as 3,000 or 4,000, and it turned out it actually tripled from there.
Wow.
Who knew?
That was a very sage prediction. So how?
Well, somewhat, but I have to tell everybody, we make mistakes too. I was during the 90s, I thought things were way overdone. I got bearish early, but you know what? I'd rather be out early than try to get out too late.
A lot of people are probably echoing that sentiment right now, I would assume, including the person you're talking to, actually.
Yeah, well, everybody's experienced some difficulties, I think.
Yeah, no question about it. Well, tell us how Elliott Wave theory works and what is so special about it. What does an Elliott Wave theorist do as they're looking at markets?
Well, the wave principle is a model. It says that the stock market is, to use a fancy term, an iterated hierarchical fractal. And what that means is there's an essential pattern or wave structure that appears at all degrees of trend, whether you're watching a daily chart, a weekly, a monthly, a yearly, and so on. The smaller patterns add together to create larger patterns with essentially the same basic shape. We didn't know the word fractal when R.N. Elliott came up with this in the late 30s and early 40s, but since then we've coined that word. Mandelbrot coined that word, wrote a book about it, and apparently, as he has shown, there are fractals throughout nature, and we think that this is an engine of social behavior in human beings. When human beings interact with each other, they share their emotional states. We call it social mood. It seems to go through stages from extreme pessimism to optimism and back again. And those show up as buying and selling on the New York Stock Exchange. They also show up in other areas, such as what clothes people choose to wear and how high women's hemlines are and how much production is going on in the economy. So it just affects everything.
Yeah, I've heard the jokes about that. You know, when the dresses get shorter, that means a bull market is coming. When the dresses get longer, a bear market is coming.
I mean, well, actually, it's a coincident indicator. So the higher the market goes, generally, the higher the hemlines, and the lower it goes, the lower the hemlines. So when they get to extreme levels, that's when you start saying, well, that's a useful indicator. We must be near a bottom or a top. So it's sort of frivolous, but
yeah.
there's some truth to why that happens.
Really? That's amazing. Yeah. Okay, good. Well, very interesting. So how does it differ from other theories? There are so many theories on markets, and especially the stock market, technical analysis, fundamental analysis, charting. I mean, this is all along the sort of the charting lines. Is that correct?
Well, it differs from all other theories because it's the only form-based model theory of the stock market. There aren't any others. Among academics, there are some currently popular models that evolved from the random walk model. Now, that was the only other one that was a form-based model. It says basically there is no form. You know, prices just wander around. And since then, there have been statistical studies showing that, in fact, the stock market does have what are called stylized statistical facts, which means, for example, big moves happen more often than they would in a bell curve. They call these fat tails. There's also volatility tends to cluster. When the market gets volatile, it tends to stay that way for a while. And when it gets calm, it tends to stay that way for a while. Random walks don't do that. So what they are doing now is trying to use statistics to modify the random walk and say, well, it's not completely random. We found these events. But those are statistical models. They're not form models. And the wave principle model actually has all the same statistics that the stock market does when you apply or when you test them for these various statistical facts. That's a very cool thing because it tells us that our model is very close to what's really going on in the stock market.
So what is the model telling us now?
Well, one of the interesting things about the wave principle model is even in discussing it, you almost cannot help but put out a forecast because when you're explaining the form, you show it, and it's rarely complete on that day. It's usually in progress somewhere. And that's what we did in our 1978 book, Elliott Wave Principle, and we said we were finishing the fourth wave. We're going to have a giant fifth wave on the upside. Well, I wrote this book, Conquer the Crash, in 2002 because that fifth wave finally ended in the first quarter of 2000, and we've been in a bear market ever since. And we had the first wave down, which we call the A wave, ending in late 2002. That was a 50% hit in S&P prices. And then there was a big recovery in the middle. Sometimes those recoveries are small. Sometimes they can actually carry nominal prices to new highs. Now, real prices got nowhere near new highs. It's been a bear market ever since 1999 in real value of stock shares. But now we're in the difficult part, the part where there's no place to hide but cash, and that's called Wave C, and it's not over yet.
So how long is that wave going to persist? I do believe we're in a deflationary segment now, although I think we're going to disagree on this. I do believe we're going to see inflation coming in the next couple of years that's going to be fairly significant. I mean, like I just finished interviewing Chris Martinson, who you may or may not know. He has a very popular course on the internet called The Crash Course, and it's every guest I talk to on the show is talking about the creation of money that is just, you look at the adjusted monetary base, the stats that the Fed puts out, and this has never before happened in history. Now credit is contracted, and so I think that's why we're seeing deflation right now, but
precisely.
You know, when credit comes back, as I think it will slowly and cautiously, and I think that's a good thing because it was obviously stupid before how it was so rampant. Aren't we going to have inflation? You put money supply with credit supply, and those two equal inflation or deflation. And right now we've got massive increase in money supply, contraction in credit supply, and so the net effect there, the aggregate of the two, is deflation.
Well, you're the first person to interview me that understands that.
Oh, really? Wow.
Absolutely.
I'm not even an economist, but, you know, then again, Al Gore is not a scientist either, so.
Well, that's right. And if you're not an economist, you don't have to unlearn so much material.
Well, okay, fair enough. I don't have any bad habits yet, huh, Bob?
That's exactly right. Well, we agree on some things, but there are nuances that I think are crucial here. In Conquer the Crash, I said they're going to try to fight this with inflationary measures. We already knew that from Bernanke, and I said it's going to fail. And so far, it's failing, you know, in spades.
Oh, it's miserable.
Stocks are down 45%. Commodities are down 60%. Property is down, you know, 40%. In some areas, it's even worse. The liquidity is drying up. The oversupply is huge. And as you say, the Fed is doing everything it can to monetize crummy debt like mortgages and stuff like that. They've doubled their balance sheet. But the Fed alone can't do it, because once people realize that the balance sheet stinks, their credibility and their own credit is going to be really going downhill. What Bernanke has managed to do, which goes further along your point, he's gone to Congress to get Congress to print even more fresh Treasury bills so they can monetize even more debt. And he wants them to shore up $700 billion worth of this and $500 billion worth of that. There are people on the web that have looked at all of the spending that's already occurred from the FDIC, the Federal Reserve, and the Treasury, and it now tops $3 trillion, and the total amount pledged is $8.7 trillion. So only one-third of the pledged spending has been done. But here's the problem. When the Fed takes mortgages from a bank, it still expects that bank eventually to take the mortgages back. Now, some people say, it never needs to do that, and that's true technically. But the Fed really doesn't want to get stuck with all this stuff. They keep telling us that the government's going to make money on their stock purchases, which is a joke. They're already down a third on average on all those stock shares they bought. The Fed's not going to make any money on this, and at some point, people are going to realize that. But the bottom line is, so far, as you pointed out, as fast as they're trying to create new money, the credit is collapsing faster than that, and we have so much credit. The whole system is saturated with credit. Banks have loaned out every dime of their deposits. It's all owed. Almost everything that's considered an asset today is an IOU. And I don't think that the Congress ultimately has the backbone to inflate. And as I explained in the book, even if it does, and even if the Fed said we're going to literally turn on the press and have greenbacks pouring out the other end, what would happen to the bond market? It would crash, as everybody says. Okay, they're going to pull a Germany on us and go into currency hyperinflation.
So you're referring to Weimar Republic, just for the listeners. Yeah.
All right. Sorry, in 1923.
Right.
If they took that route, all of the credit instruments would instantly collapse. You'd still end up with deflation. And to date, they have not done that. They have not turned on the greenback printing press. So it's a fascinating time in history. It's never been done before at this degree. But so far, everything we said is happening. They have had no net result on the stock market or the real estate market at all. I agree with you. Just one last comment. I do agree that when we've gotten rid of the entire market for credit and the debts are all wiped out, I think they'll probably turn to a hyperinflationary policy.
Any particular time frame?
Yeah, the earliest, I think, the collapse could be done would be about 2 years from today. That's based on looking at the 1929-32 experiences, which is a little less than 3 years, and the post-South Sea bubble collapse, which was a little over 2 years. That was in 1720 to 1722. However, just as has happened in Japan, the government is trying to get in the way of the collapse. And in doing so, all they're doing is prolonging it. And ultimately making it worse, because that's what they do.
I couldn't agree more, by the way, with that.
Yeah.
I think the government, if they would just get out of the way, we'd take our medicine, it would taste bad, and we'd get through it a lot faster. But they're just prolonging.
Right.
It's
right.
Just going to be a long, achy, prolonged mess if the government doesn't get out of the way, which they're not going to get
which
out of the way.
Won't.
Yeah, I know that, you know.
Yeah, every week is another grandiose plan for more inflation and meddling And not only that, they're talking about appointing, for example, a car czar. Give me a break. If General Motors can't, make it, building cars and trying to follow the consumer tastes, I certainly can't imagine some government appointee figuring it all out and making all three of those car companies profitable.
You know, it's
just a joke.
You're absolutely right. I was listening to Rush Limbaugh this morning. I happened to catch him, and he was talking about how the people in the government that are trying to solve all the problems have never produced a car. Most of them have never run a business. They've never, you know, they've never drilled and found a drop of oil. They've never done anything.
They've printed money. So
right.
I guess if they're going to throw dollars at them, taxpayer dollars or savers value, that's still a sad thing.
All they know how to do is make laws. They know how to legislate. They know how to regulate, and they don't know economics. They don't know business. It is. I mean, you know, there are exceptions, of course, but I'm just saying, making a generalization.
Yeah,
it's just unbelievable that.
And we all have to be humble in that regard. I recently was one of, I think, about a dozen speakers talking to the Georgia legislature, one of their subcommittees, about the real estate problems. And one of the things I said was, you know, when you let the free market go, nobody here, including myself, is smart enough to know how it's going to do what it's going to do. Now, for example, when Judge Green took away the AT&T monopoly in 1985, did anybody know in advance that we would have cell phones, that you could download movies onto your phone, that you could be on the top of a mountain in Chile and talk to, you know, some friend of yours 2,000 miles away, or have the internet and all of the wonderfulness that that's brought, the fact that you can go in there and get the knowledge of the world, you know, at your fingertips in seconds?
For free.
Most
of the time, yeah.
So letting the car companies go down is a great thing, because if the free market's allowed to operate, we'll have better cars made by smarter people that get 100 miles a gallon or use some alternative energy. You just don't know. But we do know that trying to bail them out is a terrible idea.
Well, I just to state my side, I do agree with you. My only proviso on that is that I hate to see sort of the last bastion of American manufacturing go away.
Well, I totally agree. But do you know one reason it's gone? Because they bailed out Chrysler in 1979.
How's that?
Had they let Chrysler go under, it would have only been GM and Ford.
Right.
And they would have shared the marketplace and had that much better income and a better base from which to try to compete with Japan. I mean, maybe one of them would have survived this.
Yeah, okay, interesting. Well, tell us about the book Conquer the Crash. You know, I just ordered it as I was talking to you here, and I'm sorry to say I'm not up on your book, but what is it telling people to do? What is your advice, and what are your predictions?
Well, first of all, a year ago you could have gotten that for about $2 used on Amazon.
but the supply has dwindled because of
the state of the
economy?
Bull market now.
Okay,
so,
good.
It's a little more expensive, but it's still worth it. I think you can buy one for $10. I don't even get the money, but that's good.
Supply and demand.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I think the book is unique. It's the only bearish book that didn't say put all your money in platinum and silver and gold and foreign stocks and foreign currencies, because I said very clearly what you want. You don't want to buy any investments, no real estate, no corporate bonds, no municipal bonds, no stocks, and no commodities. You want to hold on to your cash. I was a little bit early, but that's all coming to true now.
Okay, so your favorite investment vehicle then is cash?
Yeah, cash. Now, that's a slippery word. Some people think that money market funds hold cash, and they don't. They hold a lot of IOUs, and are those IOUs any good? The closest thing to cash we have in our fiat money system, besides actual greenbacks, and I do favor you having some of those in the house in case your bank closes, but the second best thing to own, or the closest thing to cash, are U.S. government treasury bills. And they returned a nice return in the last couple of years. Of course, now they return absolute zero.
Because there's so much demand for them as people are afraid to be in anything else. Is that why?
Yeah, precisely right. Yeah. And I also recommended the short-term bills of some other governments, and they worked well up until recent months. That was Swiss money market claims and debt of the New Zealand government and Singapore. Those, we think, are pretty strong, relatively speaking, that is, compared to the rest of the world. So, you know, a little bit of diversification in those cash equivalents, and you can just wait, because you're going to be able to buy 10 times the stock shares, 10 times the property, and all the defaulted bond paper you want in about, you know, somewhere this decade.
The interesting thing about that strategy is, you know, I'm definitely bearish on the U.S. dollar and bearish on cash. So, you know, we're going to have our differences of opinion there. But right now, at this moment, I am bullish on it. And, you know, I never, ever thought I would say this, Bob, that I have a friend who is just this ultra-conservative guy. He's a doctor. His name is John, and he was always, years ago, looking for the best deal on CDs and what CD paid the highest rates. And I tell you, if I could get 3% on my money this last year, other than my property investments, which are leveraged, and those have a whole different set of dynamics that, you know, I've gone into on the show, but they're too long to talk about here right now. That would have been, I would be jumping for joy. And I've heard Doug Fabian talk about it. He says, you know, just like you, don't forget that cash, that a CD or a money market is actually an investment.
Absolutely.
You know, and right now, in the past year, you're right. And maybe for the next year or so, I'm pretty sure you're going to be right too. But beyond that, I'm really bearish on the dollar, and I think anything denominated in dollars is really going to be destroyed in value. You talk me out of that, if you would.
Well, here's the irony.
Okay.
The reason the dollar is going up and will probably continue to go up for at least a couple more years is that it's so pitiful. Now, let me explain what I mean by that. The dollar is the most credit-inflated currency on the face of the earth.
It is disgusting.
It's disgusting.
Yeah.
And as we know, it has been deflated to about 4 cents relative to its value prior to the creation of the Federal Reserve. Right?
So 1913 to now, a dollar in 1913 is worth 4 cents today.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
Yep.
Now, that's mostly due to credit creation. So we have the biggest sea of IOUs in the world are denominated in dollars, and IOUs are what are collapsing. So the reason the dollar is strong is because we've been so profligate in creating all of these dollar-based IOUs, it's deflating more than any other currency. And that's going to continue because of the ocean of dollar-denominated debt.
Okay.
I think we're going to take back a lot of that inflation because most of it was credit. Now, the Fed, as you pointed out, is feverishly working to counter that. But at some point, I think it's going to be politically unfeasible, and that the voters are going to tell them to stop bailing people out. You know, that's the thing they never count on. It's like when we went into Iraq and we said, oh, don't worry, everybody will cheer and it'll be over in 3 days. They never think about, you know, actual human behavior and what their actions are going to create in terms of blowback. Well, here we have a period that we're in of increasingly negative social mood, and that makes people angry. It makes them fearful. It makes them more conservative in with their money. And they're not going to put up with the government bailing everybody on the face of the earth out. Pretty soon they're going to hear from the voters, and the congressmen are finally going to be in session telling each other, we can't do this or I won't get reelected. So the pressures are just huge, and I think deflation is going to win no matter what they do.
Conceptually, I understand what you're saying, and if the equation for deflation or inflation is money supply plus credit supply,
yep,
then you can measure, well, I mean, they've made that much tougher and manipulated that too, but, you know, we used to have M3, and, you know, you can try and measure the money supply. So
Try is the key word. You know, nobody can define money because we don't have any money in our system. It's all debt, including the Federal Reserve notes. I mean, even the cash in your wallet is an IOU. It's an IOU nothing. We actually have no money in the system, and that's why we have so many M's, because people have to argue about, well, which debt should we call money? It's hilarious.
Right, right. Okay, all right. So if we had money in the system, if that were different, then what do you mean? What would we have? Would we have gold or silver?
Well, gold would be absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. So just out of curiosity, do you believe in a gold standard?
No. Now, let's be very clear. I believe in gold. Gold is money. And someday, perhaps 1,000 years from now, or maybe even fewer, maybe 50 years from now, there'll be a different, if the free market might choose a different sort of money where people can have some sort of register that says, you know, I've done this amount of work and I'm registering this amount of work as a future buying ability. who knows what the creative human mind will come up with. But a gold standard means I want the government to run the money and tell me it's worth so many grains of gold, for example. Well, we've already done that. The dollar started out defined not as equal to gold. Dollar meant a certain physical amount of gold. And the pound, as we all know, started out as a pound of silver. But did either of those hold their value? So a gold standard, a silver standard, the government will ruin any standard. If we return to a gold standard, it would just be another base from which they could rip off everybody, and that's always the way it works.
Well, but not if it were 100% gold standard or 100% silver standard, right?
I mean, sure. No, we had 100% gold standard in the United States up to 1933.
We didn't have very much inflation either. I mean, that was pretty steady.
Well, you wouldn't. Not with a gold standard, because the only way to inflate is to discover and dig up more gold.
Precisely. So isn't that a good thing?
No, because governments always renege. They always renege on the standard.
Well, but that's because they can't spend. They can't discipline themselves. And
exactly.
And the gold standard forces discipline. I mean,
it doesn't. No, it doesn't.
Okay.
Because all they have to do is abandon it.
Well,
1913, they created the Fed, and we had a gold standard, and they said, "Well, no thanks." So my answer is, get the government out of the money business. They have no business having anything to do with it. They can collect it in taxes, but money is simply a good and a service. It should be provided as everything that really matters to human beings should be provided by entrepreneurs and the free market, and all the bad money would go away, and there would be amazing ways to save and spend.
And it would reduce
real money.
It would reduce speculation and these stupid schemes that Wall Street invents and are invented in the market. But how do you do that? I don't understand how you do that. Certainly, I don't think the Fed should be controlling the money supply. I don't like the government being able to print fiat money either.
Nope.
But then you say in the same breath, you know, no gold standard. I don't understand.
If we let people provide a service of money, so that you could have your money stored in a warehouse and you'd get receipts for that. And, of course, you would trade with actual pieces of paper that said, this is worth so much gold. But it's provided by the marketplace. And there may be different ways that people would denominate these things. There is actually a prototype already in place. Have you ever heard of gold money?
Yes, I have.
And James Church Company?
That's a website. Yes, gold money.
Yeah, well, they have actual gold. It's for real. It's in a vault. And you can't trade with your neighbor unless you have money that is gold in his system.
And I believe
But the government has nothing to do with it, and therefore I trust Jim Turk. I don't trust Congress.
Well, I agree with you, but the government is attacking them. I mean, I have heard that the government has attacked all sorts of websites like this.
No, they attacked another one, but not gold money. Gold money is run too well for that. Now, it could be that they will attack it anyway.
I mean,
that's not an excuse for a gold standard. That's an excuse for the government to leave people alone who are trying to provide a true money service.
The legal tender laws make it difficult to do that, right?
No, they make it impossible. Yeah. We need to repeal those.
Right. Well,
repeal the legal tender laws and get the government out of the money. But it's just like we should get them out of the educational business and get them out of health care. They're ruining everywhere they step, they ruin it.
Right.
And that's certainly true with money.
I know, but unfortunately, I don't think either of us will get our wish. I mean,
I agree. Not in our lifetime.
No, it's just the drift of politics is always to the left. It's toward more government. It's toward bigger intervention. And that's just the way things go until you have a revolution and things just fall apart and start over again. You know, that's seems like the only way to correct.
It's true. Yeah. Even in Russia, which was a total disaster for 70 years, it was total and complete ruin and bankruptcy that finally made the central planners give up.
Yeah, that's for sure. Before we wrap up here, Bob, I want to go back to that point you made about the Elliott Wave and its social interpretations and the long skirts and the short skirts and the emotions and how people talk to each other and the way that influences social life and markets. You mentioned that earlier, right, when we started today, and I found it very interesting. I'd love for you to just circle back on that, if you would.
Yeah, I'd love to talk about that just for a moment. If anyone is interested in this idea, I have a two-book set. It's available on Amazon. It's called Socionomics.
Socionomics. I'm going to look it up right now.
Okay. And a colleague of mine, Dr. Wayne Parker, and I wrote a paper that was published in the Journal of Behavioral Finance where we discussed some of the fundamental psychological differences between finance and economics. That's one of the legs of this whole idea. But in essence, my hypothesis is that social mood is regulated according to the wave principle and is therefore independent of outside events. Outside events can make people emotional for brief periods, but it doesn't change the underlying fact that social mood is endogenously regulated. That means it's got a life of its own. It's the way people interact with each other. So we have these long waves. Some people call them cycles, but I think waves is a much more accurate term. For example, uptrends, when social mood is becoming more and more positive, many things happen as a result. People get more confident, so they buy more stocks, and you start to see the stock market go up. They also get more confident in business. So a few months after the stock market turns up, you see the business numbers starting to improve. Politics tend to be less drastic, more encompassing, and more middle of the road as people cooperate with each other in this period of feeling better. Peace treaties tend to come out well after a long-term uptrend of many years or even decades. When the trend turns downward and mood tends to get more negative, people get angrier and they get more fearful, they get more conservative, they get less tolerant of each other, and you get real consequences from this change in mood. You get people selling stocks. And as you know, from a top, there's never a reason that the market's going down. People scratch their heads, you know, why is this happening? That's because it's a mood they're not aware of consciously, and there's just a few people on the margin who begin to sell their stocks. There are other people that start contracting their business plans or maybe contracting their borrowing or their lending. All of these actions have consequences. It also shows up in the taste for music. Popular music tends to be very happy and upbeat when the trend is up. And when it's negative, you tend to get, you know, depressing ballads, noisy, atonal music that's popular and that sort of thing. It permeates every aspect of our lives, from economics to politics to pop culture.
What does it do to romance and marriage? I remember, you know, seeing all the reports post 9/11 that marriages were spiking and everybody was kind of coupling up and getting married after 9/11. At the time, I had a pretty serious girlfriend. We didn't end up getting married. But, you know, I remember seeing that all over the news. That was a really rather big trend, I think. I mean, I don't know the numbers, but I heard about it a lot.
One of the trends that we've actually done the data search on going back 90 years is the rate of births as a percentage of the population, and also in arithmetic terms, tends to ebb and flow with the stock market. But oddly, it's off by about a year when we have annual data. And we finally looked at it and realized all these lows coincide together if we just move it back a year. And then I realized, well, of course, what's being regulated here with social mood trends is the rate of conceptions.
So you've got a 9-month lag there, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And what happens is a rising mood, people tend to have more babies, and in a falling mood, they tend to have fewer. This goes back as far as we have the data. And so people, you know, will say, well, demographics move the stock market. And, of course, we just like to joke and say, no, the stock market moves demographics. In other words, the social mood is making the stock market go up and down at the same time that it regulates how many children people decide to have. So it does really permeate every aspect of human interaction, but it's happening at the unconscious level. People don't know why they're being impelled to do these things and feel these ways. But they do, and we think the wave principle tracks that. So when you learn the patterns of the wave principle, you have a pretty good handle on prediction. And Conquer the Crash and the previous book from 1978 are probably the two best examples I can give where we were way ahead of a multi-decade move each direction, I think, because this one is still young, in areas that other people just can't even conceive, because you have to study 300 years of history to see what's about to happen.
That is really fascinating. So this book of yours, or this two-book set, is called Socionomics, the Science and History of Social Prediction, which, by the way, Bob, is out of stock on Amazon. There's three new ones from different vendors and one collectible version. I suppose you autographed that one probably, right?
I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah. And so that's on there. So just take on the socionomics aspect, this point in history where we are now, the snapshot in time. People are obviously, there's a downbeat mood. So what's happening? Are marriages increasing? are babies decreasing? Are you saying, though, on that thing, there are more births during optimistic times?
Yes.
Is that the trend? Okay. What about coupling?
Well, it actually follows, you know, even from the low of pessimistic times, it will rise along with the change in attitudes, yes, and then begin to fall after, you know, as the market is heading into a peak.
So I'm just trying to say, you know, like, know what's going on now. If this theory is true,
well, if this theory is right, we'll see a decline in the birth rate.
Huh. Okay. And so now, does this impact the fact that you got longer skirts? And so maybe there's not as much pursuit going on.
But every time people try to say, "Oh, well, it's due to this sort of mechanical cause," we always step back and say, "No, it's mood causing both.
Yeah.
It's causing the skirts to go down." Well, you know, men are part of that decision, too.
Sure,
know,
sure, I know.
Whether to have a child. And they just probably feel like, well, I really don't feel like having a kid. You know, I just don't feel good enough. I don't want one. I don't think they can explain it rationally.
Yeah, right.
We all know having children isn't a rational decision. We don't sit around and say, well, the benefits of having a child are as follows. We just one day wake up and say, you know, all right, it's time. Let's have a kid.
Sure. That is really fascinating. I did not know we would diverge into the socionomics aspect of this when we're talking about Elliott Wave. But that really gives it a lot more color and flavor. So that's very interesting. So anything you want to say in closing? We want to, you know, have all our listeners go get your books and so forth. But kind of sum this all up for us, if you would.
What I tell people is, to get the full benefit of all the ideas we have here at Elliott Wave International, you really don't even have to spend any money. Maybe buy one, two, or three books. The two we talked about, Conquer the Crash, actually has a couple pages in there about the wave principle, explains it very concisely, and talks for a page or two about the socionomic aspects of it. So even that one book can teach people a lot. But we also have a lot of free content on our website where we talk about the current news and how it fits into what we think. Only the people that really want to follow the markets closely have to pay for the services that we provide to, you know, serious investors and traders and that sort of thing. So just come to www.elliottwave.com, and that's Elliott with two L's and two T's, wave as on the ocean, .com.
Good stuff. Well, Bob Prechter, thank you so much for being on the show. We appreciate having you.
Well, yeah, it was a great interview, and I really, really enjoyed taking the time.
The American Monetary Association is a nonprofit venture funded by the Jason Hartman Foundation, which is dedicated to educating people about the practical effects of monetary policy and government actions on inflation, deflation, and personal freedom. Our goal is to help people prosper in the midst of uncertain economic times. This show is produced by the Jason Hartman Foundation, all rights reserved. For publication rights and media interviews, please visit www.hartmanmedia.com or email media@hartmanmedia.com. Nothing on this show should be considered specific personal or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate professional if you require individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own, and the host is acting on behalf of the Jason Hartman Foundation exclusively.